Welcome to evening prayers. It's Monday, the 10th of October. Let's pray. Father God, we ask as the evening unfolds and the night increases, as indeed the darkness increases in each day now as we are in autumn, help us to know your protection. Help us to know your guardian angels round us, your protecting love surrounding us. Your encouraging grace within us, your Holy Spirit guiding us. We come to the end of a day, maybe filled with all sorts of thoughts, feelings, rejoicing or terror, depression or joy. We come as we are, not as we hoped we would be by the end of the day. Forgive our many failings, heal us of our diseases, give us your joy and your love, we pray. You are God and we are not. Forgive us when we've taken up the part of this day thinking we control everything. Help us to again lean on your strength. We come to a God who is all love and bounty and goodness, who knows us through and through. Help us now to trust in you. We ask this for your sake, Jesus, and that we might know you better. Amen. So we're going to watch this parable. There aren't many parables in the Gospels where there's an explanation. For example, the sower, there is. And here we have the parable of the wheat and the weeds. So we have, first of all, the parable, and then it's a few verses later in Matthew 13 that we get the explanation. So we're going to have them both together in this extract from the Lumo film group. So Matthew 13, 24 to 30, and then 36 to 43.
Jesus told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, "Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where then did the weeds come from?" "An enemy did this," he replied. The servants asked him, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" "No," he answered, "because while you are pulling the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. At that time, I will tell the harvesters, 'First, collect the weeds and tie them in bundles to be burned. Then gather the wheat and bring it into my barn.'" Then he left the crowd and went into the house. His disciples came to him and said, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds in the field." He answered, "The one who sowed the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed stands for the people of the kingdom. The weeds are the people of the evil one, and the enemy who sows them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the harvesters are angels." "As the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. They will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears, let them hear."
"You're not just gonna let them die like that, are you?"
"My shoulder, Angel.
Don't listen to that guy. He's trying to lead you down the path of righteousness. I'm going to lead you down the path that rocks.
I'll come off it.
You come off it.
You.
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 You, Infinity.
Ah.
Listen up, big guy. I got three good reasons why you should just walk away. Number one, look at that guy. He's got that sissy stringy music thing.
We've been through this. It's a harp, and you know it.
All right. That's a harp. And that's a dress.
Robe.
Reason number two. Look what I can do.
But what does that have to do with him?
No, no. He's got a point.
Listen, you guys. You're sort of confusing me, so, be gone. However I get rid of you guys.
That'll work.
Hey, you're not backing down now, are you, big guy?
Where's the other guy? Yo!
Sorry, I'm late. So, what'd I miss?
Well, Yzma just tossed me this knife and asked me to, you know, take them out. And then this guy popped up, and then we waited for you. And quite honestly,
Crock! Why did I think you could do this? This one simple thing. It's like I'm talking to a monkey.
Whoa, now.
A really, really big, stupid monkey named Crock.
Ouch.
And do you want to know something else? I've never liked your spinach puffs. Never!
That's it. She's going down. Now, remember, guys. From above, the wicked shall receive their just reward. That'll work.
I love that from The Emperor's New Groove. There we are. Yeah. Do right, do wrong. Do right, do wrong. I bet we have those two angels, the angel and the devil, on our shoulders sometimes in a day. Now, the parable, you've heard it, this preached on many times, is about the world, isn't it? And about what's going on in the world, you know, the good and the bad that grow side by side. But let's not think about the world at this moment. Let's think about us. Let's own it. It's inevitable in our lives that we will have a mixture of the good and the not so good growing in us side by side. And the great thing is to let the good things flourish and the other things subside. But that is very difficult. Sometimes they're entwined in our hearts. You know, our motives for good are mixed up with our motives for not so good, or our desires to help somebody are kind of muddied and difficult. And all we can do, it's as simple as this, is let the gardener's hands be upon us. Because I know what it's like in my garden. If I make room for the things, I want to create space in my garden, it looks pretty, then the weeds very quickly come into those gaps. We have to keep weeding. It's letting the master gardener have his hands on our lives, on our hearts. It says in John 15, my Father is the gardener, and he will do what he needs to do to make sure that we are fertile and productive. We need to live and abide in Jesus and let the gardener have his way. So let's pray. Lord, we do recognize in our prayers the needs for the world to receive your good seed and fruit and fertility and productiveness, and so often it hasn't, and we know that's true of us as well. For those areas in our communities, in our churches, and in us, in the things we see on the news each day that look like the production of the tares, the weeds, help us to work to root them out as we can, but some we cannot, and to do the right thing to let your crop, your gospel crop, grow in us and in the world. Help us, Father, you're the gardener, to let you have your way. And we make this prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So we finish with Matt Redman and Abide in Me. This is a prayer we need to make if we are to, you know, those mixtures of the good and the bad in us be leaning much more towards letting God let the good be cultivated and grown in us. And with that, I shall leave you, and I'll see you again tomorrow for more out of Matthew 13.
I have a home, eternal home, but for now I walk this broken world. You walked it first, you know our pain, but you sure hope can rise again up from the grave. Abide with me, abide with me, don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me and never leave, ever close, God, abide with me. There in the night, Gethsemane, before the cross, before the nails, overwhelmed, alone you prayed, you met a sin, our suffering, and bore our shame. Abide with me, abide with me, don't let me fall, and don't let go. Walk with me and never leave, ever close, God, abide with me. Oh, love that will not ever let me go, love that will not. Sing for joy, abide with me. We'll weep no more and sing for joy, abide with me. Abide with me, abide.